So today, my name is Mark Bertrang. I am the author of Investments Don't Hug, Embracing the Life Insurance Asset. Today, we're going to be discussing some strategies that I discuss in my book and philosophy that I have in my book as far as how you can implement and more of a mindset that you should have in regards to your own planning for the future and how embracing the life insurance asset can make a difference as far as your overall planning. So one of the things that I wanted to discuss today is to cover something that we call your maximum potential. Now, what we're going to be learning today is the importance not only of saving money, that might seem obvious, but we're going to be talking not only about the importance of saving money, but you'll see by making just a couple of minor changes in other areas of your life that you can help to save more money without really changing your lifestyle at all. So we're going to pretend that we're using an example of a 30-year period of time. We're going to use an example of a 30-year period of time. And for this conversation, let's just pretend that you're 35 years of age. So if we take a 30-year period of time, that'll get us to age 65. And we're also going to make some assumptions. We've got to make some assumptions regarding income. And so you can use some math to figure out how this would work in your own situation. We are going to use the math of earnings of $100,000 per year. And we're also going to make an assumption that you don't have any current assets. Now, you might have current assets, but we basically wish to measure your ability to work. So we're only going to measure your own individual monetary value going forward. Now, this is important because most people don't understand the value of their ability to work. Now, that's one of the greatest and best assets that we have. And we tend to take it for granted. Now, at $100,000 a year over the period of the next 30 years, that would mean $3 million would be passing through your hands. So let's bring up a calculator and look at that simple example. So I'm bringing up a simple calculator that you would see on your desktop. So if I have 30 years and I times that by $100,000, just that simple math, that will provide $3 million. So you're already a millionaire. You have $3 million that's literally passing through your hands. So that's the simple math. I want to go with something with a little bit more complexity to it. So let me shut off that calculator and go with something a little bit, it's kind of like driving a 747. So I'm going to take a calculator, and this is titled Maximum Potential. This calculator is kind of like a Excel spreadsheet on steroids. The CEO and chief software engineer is actually a friend of mine, individual by the name of Todd Langford from Mount Enterprise, Texas. And he created this software, which basically uses the concepts of Excel. And it has a lot more bells and whistles, but it helps to show how things work. So if you're not in a large screen right now, you may wish to expand your screen so you can actually look at what some of these numbers are. So what I'm going to be doing here is I'm going to be taking that same period of time. So over to the left-hand side, you'll see that it says illustration period. We're going to put in 30 years. And we're going to say that the current assets that the person has is zero because we're not measuring what you've done in the past, only the work that you are doing moving forward. So we're going to take an annual income of $100,000. So you can see I'm putting in one, two, three, I have $100,000. And oh, okay, so that gives us actually a nice little graph showing us year by year what that $100,000 would look like just based on a 30-year period of time. Now, I would assume you wouldn't expect to just have your income stay the same over the period of those 30 years. You would probably expect it to go up based on inflation, based on you doing a better job for your employer. So we would anticipate that in most years that we would have an average inflation rate, an average cost of living increase, at least to the level of inflation. So let's put 4% in under where it says annual income increases. So I'm going to put a 4 right there. And what this does is this actually increases the amount of money that we're having, not only the $100,000 the first year, but then with a 4% increase, year number 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way through year 30. So if I look at the summary of values, and this is found over on the right-hand side of the screen, where it says compound, this is your income compounding, you can see that your total income has actually compounded $5.6 million over that same 30-year period of time. Now, let's also do some pretending here. Let's say that you've got the perfect job in the world. You don't have to pay for anything. You don't have to pay for your housing. You don't have to pay for your food. You don't have to pay for fuel. You don't have to pay for a car. In fact, everything is going to be taken care of in your life. If that's the case, and you could literally invest all of your income, let's say that you could do that. And let's say that you could just get a 5% rate of return on your money. Let's go over to the left-hand side of the screen again. And you can see that I've got an area there that is titled annual earnings rate. So we're going to put a 5% there. And you can see that that also changed the compound interest curve that we're showing in your maximum wealth potential. So if you look at that 5% and you go 30 years out, now if you go to the right-hand side of the screen where it says summary of values, you will see that there is, in fact, let me make a notation here. Let's see if I have an annotator. You can see right here, I've got a little red ball where now it shows with my 4% increases in salary year after year, and now with a 5% rate of return, because I didn't have to buy anything along the way, is that now I would have $11,324,721. That is truly my maximum potential. Wow. Now, if we've got somebody making $100,000 a year, but hey, what about taxes? We're also going to assume that, you know, because there's federal, there's state tax, payroll tax, social security tax, someplace we have county taxes, local sales tax, cell phone tax, hotel tax, breathing tax. Well, breathing tax, I guess we don't have that quite yet. Maybe we'll have that someday because of a carbon tax. But there's also going to be real estate tax, utility taxes, fuel taxes, all of those things we have to contend with on a regular basis. So we have to see how those potential taxes can influence our maximum wealth potential. So let's just say that if we include all those taxes together, and now we're going to highlight here right down the middle, these are our cost ratios. We're going to put in taxes, and let's say that we have about 40% of our money going to taxes. Some might think that that's going to be a little bit too low, but let's put in 40. That's what's going to support the taxes that we have to pay. So by putting 40% right there, we can see that we paid, because now we have it as a cost, $2.2 million of tax costs over the period of the next 30 years. That's listed in our total costs. But what you will see is that our future maximum potential has actually decreased from the original $24,721. If you can see kind of my red little dot in the summary of values, that now has decreased that value down to $6,794,833, or an actual cost, or let's call it an actual loss, of $4.5 million, which is listed as our actual loss. How did that happen? How did the $2.2 million of taxes actually cost us $4.5 million in actual loss? Well, unfortunately, we don't get to wait until the very end to pay all those taxes, but we pay those taxes as we go, day by day, month by month, year by year. So what happens is that money, instead of being paid at the very, very end, we paid along the way. The money was never there to earn other money for us. Instead, we have to pay it all as we go, each and every year. And when we do that, it comes out of our savings that we should have saved, and we lost the growth on that money for the rest of our lives. And as Dr. Phil would say, how's that working for you? Next, we have to talk about debt service. When you own a business, or what banks refer to it as, debt service. But what it really is the cost of holding debt. It's the debt we have, whether it's your home, student loans, personal loans, credit cards, cars, whatever. Okay. The late Nelson Nash, who coined the infinite banking concept, said that on average, 34.5% of the average American's income goes to servicing the cost of their debt. Now, if we use that number, we go into the debt service. And again, let me just highlight here. We're going to go to the debt service here in the middle. If we go there and we actually put in the number that is recommended by the think tank at Nelson Nash's group, it would be 34.5%. So we put that in there and we will see, press tab, we will see that there's additional costs that we have experienced during our lifetime. That's almost $2 million is paid out in debt that will reduce our future by almost $4 million. So what we paid in taxes might have been about $2 million. The actual loss, since we had to pay along the way and we couldn't wait until the very, very end, cost us actually about $4 million, because that money that we paid in taxes was never there to actually earn us money. Again, we're dealing with that same issue. If you don't get to wait until the end of the 30 years to pay for the debt, it's coming out year by year along the way. Now, next, what about lifestyle? Now, lifestyle is the food we eat, the cars we drive, the vacations we enjoy, the sports that our kids play, the day-to-day living of our lives, and the enjoyment that we just try to get out of everyday lives. Let's use 23.5. So I'm going to go to the middle here again, and I'm just going to highlight it so you can see exactly where we are. So I'm going to put the number in here for lifestyle. And again, that number that we're going to add in is going to be 23.5%. Now, there's also a cost to that. But remember, this is our lifestyle. This is what we're doing to live, to enjoy our lives. So the total cost to us over this 30-year period of time might be $1.3 million. But because we enjoyed the money, because we lived our lives, the actual loss over that 30-year period of time is actually $2.6 million. Now, Remember, inflation has also pushed their income up, so we've got to take a look at this as well. Our income in the very last year of our example, over here to the right, you can see that $100,000 today at a 4% increase year upon year, 30 years from now, should be approximately $311,000 just based on a 4% inflation rate. But because of the costs of taxes, because of the costs of our debt service, and because of the cost of just living our lifestyle, you can see all the red here with our maximum potential and what we have left over, looking at the right-hand side. Our original maximum potential was slightly over $11 million. Now, because of all these costs that are part of our lives, the actual amount of money that we have left over is $226,494. And really, when you think of it, when we look at our income, that very last year, that $311,000, is that really the same as having $100,000 today? Most likely not. And you know why? Because of taxes. Because of tax rates. There's something which is called a tax bracket creep. And it really is kind of creepy because after tax, even though your gross amount may have kept up with inflation, the net amount very well could be less than it was originally just because of the tax brackets that you now qualify for a higher level of taxation. Does that make any sense? And yet, let's look at this. We don't have 1 year, $226,494 in savings. We don't have 1 year of what we were making at the tail end of those 30 years. We don't have 1 year of income saved. What do most people do to fix this problem? Get a higher rate of return. Let's take on some risks. That's what they say. So many people believe that by simply taking on some risks, they will automatically have more money, right? Isn't that a little bit bizarre in their thinking? It's an interesting thing that people would preach that. Take on more risks because that means getting more money. The definition of risk really means hazard, danger, the potential for loss. When I think that many people believe that risk means that there's a higher likelihood that you're going to hit one right out of the park, but it's not really what risk entails. If you look up risk, it is the likelihood of loss. So let's just pretend that we take on that additional risk. And let's pretend that it would be risk-free. Let's say instead of a 5% rate of return, let me highlight this again. We're going to go over to the left-hand side to an annual earnings rate. Here we have 5%. Let's change that to 10. So we're going to double it. We're going to change it to 10%. Here's what has actually occurred in this calculation. Is that we went from about $226,000. We now, if you look over to the right into the savings area, we now have $520,000. So here's the thing, forgetting the risk and putting that aside, it didn't solve the problem, even though we doubled our return. And if you can't fix the problem with a 10% rate of return for 30 straight years with no down years at all, and we didn't fix the problem, why are people being sold that that's the thing to do, to take on more risk? We're focusing on the wrong problem. But who wants to think about cutting lifestyle? You? Not me. Nobody does, right? So what we want to do is that we want to try to take a little bit different approach. Let's take that annual earnings rate from the 10, and again, that's over on the left-hand side. We're taking from 10, and we're going to put back 5. So we're back to where we started from there. What if we could look at your data? And maybe we could find some places that maybe you're overpaying some sort of tax. Let's say that we could trim off your bill 10% from the tax bill. Now, I don't know if that could even be done. Not until actually seeing your data and what's going on with your life. But just stay with me. This is a concept. If you could trim off 10% from your taxes, and that doesn't mean from going to 40% to 30%. That's not 10%. It means from going to 40 to 36. 40, 39, 38, 37, 36. It means 4%. That is the change. And I can do it with my fingers. So if we could do that amount, what does that do here for you? Well, let's take a look at this. Is that we are going to move total taxes. And again, let me highlight this so you can see where it is. We're going to take total taxes, cost ratios here in the middle. And we're going to be going from 40% down to 36%, 36. We hit that button, and all of a sudden, we've gone from about $226,000. And remember, we're going to be at just over $500,000 with a 10% rate of return. With the same 5% rate of return, we have now increased the amount of money that we have to $679,483. Potentially cutting your costs can provide a better outcome than trying to double your returns. And perhaps we're not even finished there. Because if we're starting to get control and we understand how debt works, so we can start investing maybe that money and we can free that up as well. Now, to be frank, we want to make certain that we don't touch your lifestyle. But let's say that we can cut your debt service in half. So there in the middle, right now it's highlighted, we've got 34.5. Let's say that we could move that to 18% debt service by reconfiguring your debt, paying off debt, having control of debt. Let's say we cut it in half from 34.5 to 18. Whoa, we still have red, but we really have increased the amount of green. Now, this is about 8 times, if you can see this. Now we have $2.5 million left over from your original maximum potential. Remember when we were down to about 226? 8 times more than your last year's adjusted income. Now, we're actually making some headway on your part. Did we attack your lifestyle? Did we touch your lifestyle? No, we left it alone as is. Now, nobody wants to decrease their quality of life. Did we take more risk? No. We left the risk exactly where it was, at a 5% annualized rate of return. Now, that doesn't mean that we may not wish to reduce our lifestyle depending upon what your lifestyle is, okay? But the first priority is to try and find money elsewhere from those things that are already leaking from your life and falling out where they shouldn't be falling out. They shouldn't be leaking out. And this is the discussion of a scarcity mentality versus an abundance mentality. What we're trying to do is to add more abundance to a person's life. The goal is really to have both. To have it today and to have it tomorrow. Lifestyle and savings. And really, isn't that what you want for yourself? So here's the bottom line in today's discussion of Strategy Implementation 101. Are you trying to win with a higher level of risk? Do you know what your maximum potential is? Do you have money that's simply leaking out of your pockets through taxes and debt service? Do you have a plan to reduce the red in your life so you can get more green in this graph? Because again, remember, most people will end up with their taxes here, with their debt service here. And then they wonder at the end of the day, why don't they have anything to show for it? As you ponder this, I also want you to be thinking about other things. I want you to consider purchasing my book, Investments Don't Hug, Embracing the Life Insurance Asset. This is available on Audible, on iTunes, if you wish to listen. It's also available through Amazon, Barnes & Noble. Any of those resources are available. I talk about some of the concepts inside this book each and every week. We're going to be talking about different concepts, things that people may not have thought about in the past. Some of these topics I talk about on my blog, investmentsdonthug.com, everything without the apostrophe. And we also share some of this information in my ongoing audio podcast. I would have you go to wherever you typically look to find your podcast. Look for Discovering Wisdom Over Coffee with Mark Bertrand. And if you like what you hear, like us. Now, in the comments area, you can put in questions that you are wondering about, you're considering, different topics that you would like us to discuss. There are many different things that I think a person should be considering as they are planning ahead. And we will continue with our discussion again next Wednesday at 12:15, and we'll present additional ideas regarding Strategy Implementation 101, based upon my book, Investments Don't Hug, Embracing the Life Insurance Asset. Thank you for joining us today. Appreciate it. Be well.